Hey guys, how are you doing today? It is International Women's Day. It is Wednesday, so to all my other ladies out there, happy International Women's Day. I'm not wearing red today, but I didn't really have anything red to wear, so I'm just wearing my clothes. Anyway, welcome to the Littlebean and Me podcast channel. My name is Kayleen. I am your host. This is a little podcast about knitting, crocheting, mostly yarn dyeing, some spinning sometimes, and pretty much just all the crafty things that I do. So if you've just stumbled upon this, welcome, and if you're interested in things like that, then just stick around and we'll be talking about some things. I have a few things. One, if you're not subscribed and you'd like to be, there's always a button down below that you can hit to subscribe if you're liking what you see on this channel. You can always hit the like button down below if you're liking what you're seeing, and that lets me know that you're liking the content I'm putting out to you. And then if you wanted to, you're welcome to come and join our Ravelry group. I always forget to mention the Ravelry group, but down in the comments, down bar below, I always list timestamps of the things that I'm going to be discussing, relevant links for patterns or yarns or my own shop. So you can always find those links down below. So if you go check down there, there's a link for my website, which is www.littlebeanlovesyarn.com. We also have the Ravelry group on Ravelry. So if you go to the groups tab and search Little Bean and Me podcast, you'll find us there. We're a small and albeit a little quiet group, but I'm not super active on Ravelry, but it's a place for you guys to join in, and it's where I host giveaways. And if you guys feel like chatting or starting a thread or comments or questions, then you're always welcome to. I think there's about 100 people in there. So hey guys, if you're watching, I hope you're enjoying this podcast. Okay, so let's talk about one thing first, and that is our family's rampant illness. So as you can see, I'm feeling very good today. The last podcast was filmed last Friday, which, well, not this past Friday, but the previous Friday. So it was the day before that I fell dreadfully ill. You could hear me coughing through the podcast, and as I was editing, I was getting so upset that I had to keep editing out all of these coughs. But I should have taken it as a sign that I was soon to fall ill, and certainly I did. Right as Cece was starting to feel better, I couldn't even get out of bed. So my wonderful husband, who is an angel saint, just perfect for me. I mean, he's just fantastic. Took over while I was sick for 2 days, and he said, "I don't know how stay-at-home moms do it." So kudos come from my husband to all you stay-at-home or work-at-home moms or dads who do it every day, because it's not easy. So I was sick for a few days, and I think around day five of me starting to feel better, or day five of my illness, it wasn't the flu, although it felt incredibly like the flu, but my son got it. So he's only a year and a half, which is kind of scary and a little disheartening, because once you think you're over everything, the next person gets it because it's had enough time to kind of stew and be like active in their system. So yeah, anyway, so he's feeling better, Cece's better, I'm feeling better. Tyler's a little bit sick with a cold, but he can deal with that. I'm not going to shoulder that burden. So I just wanted to give you guys an update, and thank you all very, very much for all the well wishes and prayers and thoughts and juju that came our way on social media, through Facebook and Instagram. I read all of your comments, and I just want to say thank you very much for your well wishes, because somehow they're heard and somehow we're feeling better, and I'm hoping that this, knock on wood, is the end of the cycle here. So let's get into crafty things. I have some maybe little obvious finished objects for you today. I have one work in progress. I wanted to share a little favorite of mine. And then I want to show some yarn. I don't have any acquisitions, but I do have some yarn that I dyed up this week for shop update. And then I want to do a little teaser, because hint, hint, nudge, I have a collaboration coming up with Lynn over at the Sunshine and Bubblegum podcast. I talked maybe a month or two ago about doing another bag collaboration where Lynn creates a small sock bag and I create some sock yarn and we put it together for a lovely little kit, and those will be coming to you soon. I will show you a little bit of what's happening with that. Anyway, so let's just get into it. I may get interrupted. Who knows? Cece is watching some television. She's allowed to watch TV during this time, so she may or may not be occupied enough. We'll see. Okay, finished object number one is the hat that you see me wearing. I finished this hat that evening. So the day I filmed my podcast that Friday, I ended up finishing up this hat that evening. So I'm gonna take it off. I don't normally wear hats because I feel like my head is a very strange shape, and I almost always have my hair up in a bun or a ponytail. It's just the way my hair is. I'm not entirely in love with my hair. I never really have been. Let's not get into that. So but I made this into a hat. Let's see, I don't look, apologies for like the flat hair, but okay, so this is the hat that I started crocheting and then ripped out and then put a knit border on and then couldn't decide what I wanted to do with it. I had some really cool suggestions, and one that just came I think yesterday in the comments of that video where they said do a convertible hat where you can just drawstring the top and then make it like a, it's a convertible, so you could either wear it as a cowl or cinch it and wear it as a hat, which is actually a really cool idea, and I wish I had seen it before I finished it off, but I did finish it. But I do really like that idea, so thank you. I can't remember who said it. Maybe I'll put your name down here on the screen, but I'm awful at remembering people. So this is the hat. It's a little blown out right now, but this was in my skein of Pandora yarn from Woolen Vine Yarns in her Volca base, which is an MCN. Very cushy merino cashmere nylon base. So here it is. I'm not sure. There we go. That's very much true to color. You can see it's very speckled. It's got a creamy tone, so it's just really this natural nice yarn color, like a creamy, actually maybe she did dye it with some cream color, but with pink speckling and black speckling. I held it double and I used this star stitch, which you can see here. Oop, don't focus me, focus that. You can see here the star stitch. So I did it this way actually. I crocheted, did a chainless foundation. I did several rows of just star stitch, which is a two row repeat. If you've never done a star stitch, it's actually quite easy. It's a lot like a puff stitch where you're inserting your hook back into the same stitch over and over to pick up loops and then drawing and pulling through, but it just makes this cool star shape. So one row is that, and then one row is doing two, I did half double crochets in the peak of each star to create the finished pattern. So I ended up just finishing off the hat using some, I think these are half doubles as well. I did a row of singles to kind of give it some stability at the top, and you can see the decreases here. It's a bit holey because that's how I wanted it. But yeah, so I just decreased using knit two together. Oh my gosh, I've been knitting so much. Half double crochet two together, and then a round of half double crochets, and then half double crocheting two together again, then just continuing doing the two together. So two stitches together, just spiraling in and in and in until I closed up the hat. It's not the neatest closure, but I don't see it and I really don't care who sees it in the back of my head. So here's the back seam. So this is worked in the round. There were several rows where you could see there are these larger holes, and I was having some issues. I was doing this while I was taking care of Cece, so it was kind of like I kept messing up where I was putting my single half double crochet here. So like along the seam, you'll see there's like a single half double crochet after the last star stitch. And you know, if you jog where it goes, whether it's right next to the chain ups for each row or right next to it, you'll avoid having this spiraling line going up the course of your hat. And so somehow I got off on that and I didn't hold my tension tight enough, so I ended up with some holes. Generally this has holes in it, so I wasn't too worried about it, but that is the big flaw. So it fits very nicely. I'll see if I can get a nice shot here of the back of the hat. This is going to be a challenge, I think. But you can see the brim fits really nicely. It's not, it's stretchy, but it's not too snug. It is very slouchy in the back. You can see this is all the extra fabric. But I like that it's crochet and knit because I do both, and I like to try and incorporate both when I'm freehanding projects. And with crochet, I often do freehand projects unless there's a certain pattern that I like. So this was my finished object number one. I'm very proud of it. I've been wearing it a lot, which means I've been wearing my hair down a lot, you know, because I feel like I look very weird if I don't wear my hair down. I mean, if I don't wear my hair up, or if I wear my hair up and I have a hat on. So let's get into a couple more things. One is a finished object and one is a work in progress, but they're both for a baby shower this Sunday. So let me grab those. So my friend, Laurie, she is pregnant and I don't want to spoil any surprises. So I'm not sure if she watches these at all or weekly or at all. I don't know if she watches, but if you do watch, Laurie, please look away. I will try and remember to put a timestamp here, so if you want to just fast forward to that point, it will be safe to look, but these are gifts for you, so don't spoil them. I did tease my work in progress on Instagram, but it was just freshly cast on, so you can't even really see what it is. But I'm going to start with my finished object, which is a bowl. So I talked a few weeks ago about t-shirt yarn because Andy from the Andre Sunitz podcast, she was talking about making your own t-shirt yarn. So I had talked about my little collection of t-shirt yarn and what I like to use it for. And so I do like to use it to make bowls. These are very easy to make. They are made using a large hook. So this is a 10 millimeter bamboo crochet hook, US size 15. I don't know if we can get it to focus. Here we go. So US 15 or 10 millimeter bamboo crochet hook. When I am using a crochet hook this big, I do crochet like a knife, like this way, because it is uncomfortable for my fingers to crochet and make this motion with such a thick material, and also not a very forgiving material when it comes to like sliding your hook and having some fabric with stretch. So anyway, so this is a bowl. I did a magic loop for the beginning part, which is the center part, and I did all single crochets. So I began by, you're not going to be able to see exactly what I did here, but it's worked in a spiral. So I did, I don't know, 8 single crochets, I think. And then I began working out in the spiraling motion where I was increasing by 2 every stitch, so 2 single crochets per stitch. And then when I finished that round, I just automatically started going 1 and then 2 and then 1, 1, 2 and then 1, 1, 1, 2. So I was increasing by 8 stitches every single row, which makes traditionally a beanie shape. So you can see that it slopes out gently, but because the material is really flexible, it tends to sit nice and flat. And then once I was done increasing, when I had the diameter that I knew I wanted for the bowl, I started just doing 1 single crochet around in a spiral, continuing until I had it as tall as I wanted. And then I finished with a slip stitch border that you can see right there across the top of the bowl, which gives the top of the bowl this nice clean edge. It's not perfect because it's worked in a spiral, so when you get here, this was where the spiral was supposed to continue going upwards, but it's a bit disguised. It's not going to be something that you're going to be staring at and be like, oh, there's a jog here. But it's pretty seamless. It is large enough for this crochet hook. But I like to make these for baby gifts because they are very versatile. You can use them in the baby's room for toys or for diaper changing materials like wipes or creams or lotions or salves or a thermometer or whatever. And they're small enough that they can fit on pretty much any surface, a side table or on the edge of the changing table. And they're a bit malleable, so you can make them into any shape that you need. And also, because they're made of t-shirt yarn, you can always throw these in the washing machine and just wash them. It's going to fade the fabric or whatever, but if you're just using it and it gets all gross, you can just throw it in the laundry. So that is one gift. That's the next finished object that I have. This was the t-shirt yarn that I used. This is from Fabuloop. If you've never seen t-shirt yarn, I definitely recommend going over to Fabuloop's Etsy shop. They have a standalone website, I believe, and also an Etsy shop. But they are super nice. I was buying tons of this stuff for a while. I was making teething rings, and they had really great customer service. Even when I had some trouble with one of the colors. Wow, it just got bright. When I was having trouble, one of the colors didn't come the color that I expected, and she kind of explained things to me. She was very patient, very nice. I liked her a lot. So this was t-shirt yarn. It's just a green and navy, kind of like a sailor stripe almost, and it is jersey fabric, so it's knit fabric. It has not that much stretch, but it does have a slight amount of give, so it's not too stiff when you're working with it. Let's wrap it back up. Okay, so anyway, that is it. I'll leave the link for Fabuloop down below, but that's where I always recommend to go, and their prices are reasonable. This was a large skein, so I can usually get two small size bowls out of a large skein of this, so it's very useful. I find it very useful. If I had more surfaces, I'd probably be populating them with more crocheted bowls, but I don't have that many surfaces to put bowls on. Okay, and then the last gift that I was knitting up, I cast on earlier this week, I think on Monday, a couple days ago at least, and it's a hat. So it's in my little sock sack. Wow, the sun decided to come out, how amazing. This is in my little casual fashion queen bag. I love this little bag. She makes these little sock sacks that she usually puts with her kits for sock yarn, but I like these for single skein projects too. I'm really liking it. Sheena, this is a winner. I love this thing. So anyway, I cast on a baby hat, so Laurie doesn't know if it's a boy or a girl. They're not finding out, so I didn't want to do anything that was too masculine or too feminine. So this blue and green, I thought, sorry if I just blew out anybody's eardrums with that loud crash, but the blue and green is pretty neutral. It can be dressed up or dressed down, put in any style of room, it doesn't matter. And then I'm making this baby hat. So I cast this on using my Wig and Tree colorway, which is one of my most favorite colorways, but also one of my most complicated colorways I talked about last time. But I had this remainder of a skein of my Simple DK base, which is just a single ply superwash merino. And I decided to cast on a baby hat for her. So I didn't want to do a tiny baby hat. So I would say this is probably, you know, a 12 month size, maybe a little like an 18 month size. I cast them on using my 6mm Nova Platinas on a 16 inch cable. I'm finding it just fine to knit on in stockinette, just going round and round and round. And I can't remember how many stitches I cast on. It's that bad. I'm so used to crochet and I'm like, I'll just do however many I want. I think it's somewhere in the 80 stitches range. But yeah, so this is the colorway. And it's very pretty. It's very fall. It's kind of neutral. It has reds and browns and purples and greens and oranges. And it can be good for a boy or a girl. So I'm working on this. It's very simple, mindless knit that I can just pick up and put down. I pick things up and put them down. Sorry. Oh, can you tell I'm feeling a little better? I'm getting a little goofy. Anyway, so that is probably 50% done. I'm not rushing through it. I'm just trying to do a little bit every single day. with my circulars, since they're so small, I think I'm just gonna end up doing two circular needles when I have to do the decreases, because I don't have any DPNs that are a size 6. So there's that. But anyway, it's coming along quite nicely. I'm enjoying the project and I'm very happy to bring this to baby shower on Sunday, which will be really fun, I think. Okay, so I always say so a lot. Do you notice that? I say so. I end up editing out so many so's. Okay, let's see. All right, so that's all I have for knitting and crochet content today. I haven't been super busy with crafting because, again, my kids have been sick. I was happy to cast on that hat, but I am thinking about what I want to cast on next. I think I might want to make some socks on my machine using one of my sock blanks, because I want to see how it knits up. I have to just pick one that I like the best, but that might be my next project. And yeah, so that's really all I have for knitting and crochet content today. I am going to move on now to a dye topic. So last time and the time before, I had talked about mistakes and the mistakes that happen sometimes when you're dyeing. You know, either it's your fault or it's not your fault. Sometimes dyes don't behave the same way and under different conditions. And sometimes, you know, there's mysterious dye that stays on your pot and you can't see it until you put the berry yarn in and you're like, why is there yellow dye in my blue skein of yarn? Type stuff. So I did show some skeins last week that were the Lost Diadem colorway, which is a gray tonal with some blue speckles, and they didn't come out the way I wanted because I had some contamination of pink dye, and I said, oh, I'm probably just gonna over dye these. And everybody in the comments was saying, I love your mistakes, you shouldn't call them mistakes. You know, there are no mistakes, just happy accidents, and nothing ever really goes to waste. So if there's something that's unexpected in a colorway, I usually try and make it something even more beautiful. And that's just how I view things in life, I suppose. I always try to make the best out of poor situations. And so, at least poor in terms of expectations. So the expectation of a color being gray and blue and seeing these bright pink spots on it, you're like, why is this like this? So I overdyed it, and I'm gonna show you the result of the overdye. So here, this is the skein of what is now called Divination, but this was the overdye result. So I kind of wrote down what I did. I did make some adjustments in the final colorway. There we go. And you can see there is the blue speckling and the lighter gray, and then there's some darker gray and black, and then some purple spots and speckling I used to kind of pull in those pink tones and overdye those pink tones. So this was the overdye, one of the skeins. I had 4. I think there are 3 left, including this one. So this is Divination, and I will show you yesterday, or the day before. I think it was the day before. I dyed up more Divination. So here is the result. On the bottom is Luck Sock, and the top is Sparkle Sock, and I still have several skeins of this available in the shop. I had posted it up, I think, on Monday. So this is what it looks like. I did adjust the recipe a little bit, so you'll see that this one has more black, but I like how they all came out. I think they came out very nicely. So it has the blue and the purple and the darker gray, and it was fun to see how it dyes up differently on different bases. That's why I like dyeing across several bases, because you can see how different types of yarn and different compositions, like this is merino nylon and stellina, and then this is merino nylon and cashmere. So you can see the difference in how intense the coloring is. They're both superwash bases. You know, how deep the dark tones get, how speckled the speckles look, how much variation there is between even the same skeins on the same dye lot. So yeah, this was the mistake rectified, and I had a lot of fun doing it, and I'm happy that I remembered the recipe so that I can repeat it for you guys. So there are some skeins available in the shop for those. So I did have a couple of questions through the last week or so. I can't remember who asked where, when, but there were two questions. One question, I believe, came on Instagram, but it was someone asking that if you can use too much citric acid in your dyeing, or use too much of an acid like vinegar when you're dyeing yarn, which I will answer. And then also I had another person, forgive me, I don't remember who it is, but I think it came on the Ravelry group. They asked for tips on speckling. So the answer to the question about citric acid is, of course you can use too much citric acid if you're dyeing something like stellina. So stellina is a non-metallic fiber. Well, it's metallic looking, but it's not metal. And what happens is, if you are using too much heat or too much acid and or too much acid, what happens is the stellina can kind of dull. It's very frustrating because stellina yarn is difficult to dye because of that. You can always use vinegar. I don't, only because I don't like the smell of vinegar. And I know you, once you wash it, you're not going to be able to tell what was used as an acid, but I just don't like the smell of cooking vinegar. It just makes me stick to my stomach. So I always use citric acid. But when I'm dyeing stellina skeins, I'm always very cognizant of how much citric acid is going in. What I mean by that is, you need to put in so much for so much water and yarn that you're going to be dyeing. And when you dye stellina, you want to be on the lighter end of the amount of acid that you need. Now, different colors sometimes require different pH levels in the water in order to fully exhaust, or to exhaust well and quickly. But generally, you don't want to use too much acid when you're dyeing a stellina yarn, because it will dull down the shine, so to speak. And also, if you are using too much heat, if your water comes to a boil, stays at a boil, or if you're steaming your yarn, you can risk kind of melting the stellina away. And that's happened to me before, where I have two kids, so I dye my yarn, and then, you know, sometimes I have to let it simmer on the stove while I take care of other things around the house. And there have been several occasions, and I think some I had even posted on Instagram, where I pretty much killed the sparkle in my stellina, where I left the room and then I came back and water's boiling and all the stellina is kind of gone, and I'm just like, are you kidding me? So I'll show you one of the skeins that was in that photo, but it was just a black tonal, but it's so obvious when the stellina is gone. So I'll show you that in 1 second. Okay, so I'm going to show you this. I also had to re-dye this because you can see I have a bald spot. So I'm going to show you these two yarns next to each other. Whoa! And we'll see if we can get a decent picture about how stellina reacts. So again, I'm saying so a lot. Hey, so you can see here that the stellina is extremely obvious in the darker places. So if I hold it up and I can catch it on the camera, you can see the stellina is super obvious. You can even see it when you're not moving the yarn, which means, you know, my stellina did what it was supposed to do. It didn't absorb any of the dye, which can also happen if your colorway is super saturated. But you can see here, this is a black yarn, or gray, like a charcoal color. And you can see that the stellina is very much less obvious in this skein than it is in this skein. Here you can see all the shiny twinklies on the darker bits, and you can barely see them in this skein. Now, this is a boo-boo skein. This is something that I might just make into minis and, you know, use for my own personal use. Which is fine, but the stellina is much more difficult to see. So if you receive a skein of yarn, like say it's darker and you can barely see the stellina in it, chances are something like that might have happened and the dyer didn't know, or they think this is how stellina should look. But this is not how stellina should look. On lighter colors, it's more difficult to tell. But if you really struggle, like I have to really move this around to see the stellina, but it's very dulled down and it's almost gone. So some of it got over dyed with the black, but the black skein that I sent out, it was so obviously stellina yarn with a nice black base. So it looks like twinkling stars. That's what it should look like when you are dyeing with Stellina. So yeah, so this is it. And let's see it on the lighter base. So this is Flowers for Dobby. And see how you can see all of this twinkling stuff even when I'm not moving the yarn? This is a lighter color, so it's always more difficult to tell for Stellina. In real life, when I'm looking at these two together, I can see the Stellina in this more. Can you see how shiny this is? It almost looks like wet. See how shiny that is? And then this is not as shiny. And it should be even shinier because the darker the yarn, the easier it is to see the Stellina. So, anyway, I digress. But that's another topic to talk about and something to know if you're planning on dyeing any yarn for yourself, for others, whatever, that Stellina is temperamental and it's difficult to work with. But you can do it. It's all about learning and experimentation and kind of learning as you go and just understanding the chemistry behind dyeing and how the dye bath affects the final product. So the other question I had was tips for speckling. Speckling, almost as elusive as Stellina, it's a technique that I am even still refining for myself in my own yarn. But speckling happens when you have short changes of color. So like a small, like an inch of color in one spot on the yarn. And when you stitch, it's like one or two stitches and it will give this speckled effect. There are several ways to speckle. You can sprinkle dye powder onto your yarn, but there's a couple things to be warned about that. One, it's really dangerous sprinkling dye powder everywhere because it becomes air, like in the air and you can breathe it in and it can hurt you. So you always should be wearing safety protective gear if you're dealing with the powder, whether you're mixing dye stock or speckling using powders. And then you could also use droppers. You could use different techniques of pouring the dye into the pan to create shorter color changes, which I can show you a little bit as well. But generally, if you're going to be speckling using, say, dry powder, you want to have lower water in your pan. And the temperature needs to be at temperature for the speckling to take hold and not bleed into any other colors. So if you have too low of heat or you have too much water, then you're gonna have a lot of trouble speckling and it can just run everywhere and just not give you the intended effect. So this is Flowers for Dobby. This batch actually came out quite delicate in terms of speckling and it also came out a lot creamier feeling, not as creamy as this hat. This is still gray toned, but less striking gray or, you know, kind of grayish spots. So I'll show you these skeins. So doing something like this is extremely difficult to adequately speckle. Like these are very, very small speckles. So when you knit it up, you're just gonna have these delicate blips of color, kind of like what you see here. What Kristen did with this yarn is a very similar type of technique where you have these tiny little bleep, 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 bleep speckles everywhere. This was done with dry dye powder. So when I dye something like this, when I get to the speckling phase of the dye, I always have to make sure that the water is low, the water is like lower so that the yarn that I want to have the most intense color is right at the surface, that I speckle accordingly and that I let it set, because if you move the yarn or you have too much water in there, it's going to bleed more and it's okay. I mean, it's just not your intended effect for the yarn. So this was my intended effect, was to have a delicate pink speckle in this yarn. This yarn also has speckling in it. So you can see here, this has darker green speckles and brown tones, but you can see the darker specks of color. This skein has speckling, but it's a different technique. You can still see darker sections of color, but these skeins had a little more spreading of the color, but it's still speckled. It's going to come up in a speckled way when you stitch it up. So yeah, I don't think I have any other speckled yarns that are sitting next to me. So it's just a matter of getting the dye in the right place, in the right concentration, using the right amount of water and heat. I feel like that's what I say, I repeat myself over and over again, but that's really what it is. Okay, so here's another example of speckling. So this is my Looney colorway. And as you can see here, there are splotches of color all over the skein. There are some specks of green, navies, and kind of sandy browns. That's kind of the overall color palette for this skein. And this is what it looks like caked up. So you can see the specks of green, navy, sand. And then it's using liquid, like dye liquid, but a certain type of technique that lends itself to a speckled appearance when it's dyed. So, I mean, when it's dyed, lends itself to a speckled appearance when it's knit up. So this is it in a sock. I've shown this sock before, but I'm going to show it again because it's a good example of speckling. But I didn't use dry dye powder. The method by which I dyed, I lay the dye in a pan a certain way. It actually gave this interesting pooling effect when I did it in a sock, but you can see that there are speckles of navy. Will this please focus? You can see there's speckles of navy, green, darker browns, sandy browns, and it gives this really kind of cool effect. So that is my ramble about speckling. Make sure your water level is right. Make sure that the concentration of your dye is right, whether you're using a liquid dye stock or you're using dye powder. Wow, the light is so dynamic today. I apologize, guys. I don't know how much I'm gonna be able to correct in post-production, but hello. Okay, so creepy, right? Creepy. Okay, here's better light. We're back to our light. So yeah. So this was using liquid dye stock. This was using dry powder. This was using a combination of both of those techniques. This was done using dry dye powder. So it just depends on the recipe, the intended effect that you're going for, the color palette that you're using. You know, it's just all the variables together. What's your intended effect? So get your acidity right, your heat right, your water level right, and then just go to town and have fun and try different techniques of laying dye in your pan and see what comes out. That's the best way to do it. It's the most fun way to do it. And then knit up what you just dyed, because that's always really fun. So that is it for speckling. So the last thing I had for you guys today is a little bit of teaser for the collaboration with Lynn at Sunshine and Bubblegum, and also kind of going over what's in my shop right now and changes to my shop. So, and then I might do a little chatter at the end, but I think I really covered the chatter at this point. So, if that's all you guys are interested in, then I'll see you next time. But if you're interested in what I have for shop update, changes to my website, and also the collaboration with Lynn, then just stay where you are and we'll chat about that. Just turn the camera on and immediately drop the yarn that I needed. Okie dokie. Let's talk about shop update. So there are a few things to talk about here. One is I've done a revamp of my website, littlebeanlovesyarn.com. I was using a website that was linked directly with Etsy, so the listings would show up on the website, but you would check out. It would be an Etsy process during checkout. It was through Pattern, which is the company that Etsy is collaborating with. I gave it a few months to kind of see the traffic to the website, the amount of sales that come through the website versus directly through Etsy, and the layout and what I wanted to see out of my own site. And so I kind of came to the determination that not that I didn't like how it looked, because I did like how it looked, I just wasn't seeing what I wanted to see in the format I wanted to see it, so to speak. So right now I am still selling through Etsy. You can always find my yarn at littlebeancrochet.etsy.com. You can always go to my website, which is littlebeanlovesyarn.com, which makes it nice for web searches, because if you're searching Littlebean Loves Yarn, Littlebean Loves Hand Painted Yarn, it should direct you to my Etsy shop and direct you to my website. So on my website, I will try and overlay, let's see if I can scoot over. So I'm going to try and overlay some footage of my website here. When you go to littlebeanlovesyarn.com, you'll see that the look has changed in a good way, I think. So I transferred my site over to a different platform that was a little more flexible for me and what I wanted to see. And you can see on the main page, there's some pretty pictures of yarn that come up, a little introduction message for all of you lovely crafters out there, my Instagram feed, my other social media feeds. And then as you click along the top of the page, there are different sections for different things. So right now you will see the About Me section, where I have a small description of me on the website, who I am, how I started dyeing yarn, what my shop is all about. And then on the next page, you'll see bases. So it's where I describe all of my yarn bases that I currently carry in the shop, which I think I'm going to start paring down a little bit, only to kind of hone in on seasonal things. You know, having more bulky available during the winter, for example, having more sock weight yarn available through the summer, just going by seasons. But you can see the descriptions there. On the next page, you can see the colorways. So as I have improved my shop and grown as an artist and grown as a business, I've improved the quality of my photos. So as I have dyed colorways or some of my older colorways, I've taken more professional looking photos, more consistent photos where I have very good color representation. And so I put all of my repeatable colorways that I currently have really nice photos for in this section, and you can see the photo and the name. And if you click on the photo, you would see the picture zoomed in, so you can get a nice detailed look at generally what the colorway should be looking like. Again, dye lots vary, and you know, different bases take dyes differently, so it's just a general idea of the palette that you'd be getting for colors. Then if you click on the Shop Now button, that will take you direct to my Etsy website in a new window, as well as the podcast button, which will take you here to YouTube, where you can check out my weekly podcast. And then a contact us form, where you can send me messages if you'd like to do so, if you have questions or comments about colors or the podcast or the website in general. I do ask you to reserve any requests for colorways to go through Etsy, just so I can keep all of those messages in the same place, because I do check Etsy very, very frequently. And yeah, so that's like the entire website. I think it's very clean looking. I think it achieves the goals that I want to achieve in terms of giving you guys a website where you can find all of my information, not just some of my information, and I can choose how to show it to you rather than being given a specific rigid criteria. My website before really just had all of my yarn for sale, and then other parts of the website you couldn't really get to or read if you wanted to read about other things. So anyway, I hope you guys enjoyed that little tour of the website. So that is new. I got a very wonderful shout out on both Mina and Katie's channel. So if you've not seen the Knitting Expat podcast, that's Mina Phillips' channel. She does a weekly podcast. Well, she just had a baby, but she gave my shop a shout on her most recent episode, which was all about her little daughter. Oh, she's so adorable. So congratulations again, Mina. And I also got a shout out on Katie's podcast. So Katie does the Inside Number 23 podcast in Hertfordshire, England, and I sent her some yarn for part of a giveaway and also some yarn for her, and so I got a ton of custom dye requests and everything all at once this week. It was very overwhelming. I think I have a visitor now. Yes?
I just got my egg.
You want to show your egg? Come here, you want to show it on the camera?
Yes.
Okay, I guess we're gonna take a little segue. So, you got your egg?
Yes, that's silly.
Yeah? What did you get it for?
At the Target.
You got it at Target?
Yes.
What was inside?
It was paper.
It was paper, and what else?
And crayons.
And crayons, and what else?
And stickers.
And stickers, too? Yes. Why did you get it? Why did we get it at Target today? What did you do that was really good?
I don't know.
What did you earn?
I don't know.
You don't know? Did you go on the potty? Did you earn all your stickers for the potty?
Yeah.
Yes, you did.
Yeah.
And so you got your special prize?
Yes.
We're potty training, so.
Yeah.
Yep. Sit up nice and tall. There you go.
Yeah.
So you earned your special egg?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Did you like your egg?
Yes, this is like it.
What color is it?
It's pink.
Do you like pink?
Yes. My favorite color.
Is your favorite color?
Yeah, just like the crayons.
Just like the crayons.
There's nothing in there.
No, did you take everything out?
Yes.
Can you close it?
There it is.
Do you need something? What do you need?
I want to see.
I don't know. Do you need something to eat? Do you need me to pick your nose?
No.
Do you need me to tickle your belly?
No, that's not to eat.
What do you need?
How about grapes and blueberries and strawberries?
Grapes and blueberries and strawberries?
Yes.
I think Mommy can do that for you in a couple minutes.
Yeah.
Can I finish recording my little podcast?
Yes, I can finish this too.
You can finish this too?
Yes, I can show my egg again.
Okay, you show your egg again. And then Mommy's gonna finish showing the yarn and then I'll get you a snack.
Yes, this is a beautiful egg.
It is a beautiful egg.
It's pink and on the camera. See? It's pink, it's on the camera.
That's right, it's on the camera. So Mommy's gonna finish showing off all this yarn, but when I'm done, then I'll come and bring you a snack, okay?
And I almost broke it, then I almost see something.
All right, we'll see you later. Okay, you say bye?
Bye.
Bye. Okay, all right. After that segue, let's get into shop update information. So anyway, I got a lovely shout out on those two podcasts, and so I got a flood of custom color requests, and I had to take off all of my dye to order stuff because I was getting extremely overwhelmed with the kids being sick and then getting this huge surge of custom requests. I still have a couple of orders in my queue, so if you haven't received an order from me and you placed an order in the last week or so, just hang tight. I'm almost done with this surge of people, and your yarn will be coming to you very shortly. Anyway, so I think I'm going to start changing how I organize my Etsy shop, because as I've grown as a business, I used to do almost exclusively dye to order requests for certain colorways because the amount of people requesting them was so small. And I always kept them open, and I really liked having the listings open on Etsy because more listings means more exposure for my yarn and for the people who are looking for specific yarns. And if I don't happen to have something stocked in the shop, that they can always dye to order a custom request. Well, given the circumstances, which is good for me, which means I'm getting busier, but not so great to have that readily available ordering capability for you guys, I'm going to start changing how I do my dye to order requests. So right now all my dye to order requests are off the website except for the tonal skeins, so 100 gram and mini skein tonals, as well as the mini skein sets, which are just tonal mini skein sets. I still have those up as dye to order. Those are still there. I don't think I'm going to remove those. But in terms of other colorways, more complicated colorways, I can't do custom requests for just a single skein of something anymore, only because the numbers are getting just too much for me to handle in terms of my own time and the abilities that I have during the day. I don't want to overextend myself. I want to still keep providing you guys with quick shipping and good customer service because that's something that's super important to me. So I'm going to have to kind of pair off the customs requests. Now, that being said, I'm happy to still entertain customs orders requests, but for larger amounts So 2 skeins or more per color, only whether it's on the same base or not, but per color, because the time it takes to dye 1 skein of yarn is the same amount of time that it takes to dye 4 skeins of yarn, because I usually do dye lots up to 4, sometimes 6 or 8 depending on the project. If you've ever messaged me for a larger quantity of yarn, you know that I'm able to do large dye lots for sweaters or blankets and such. So so I'm able to do custom dye requests, but for 2 or more skeins of a certain colorway. So if you like it on worsted and on sock weight, you can order 2 skeins from me of the same color and I'm happy to do it for you. But doing constant single skein order requests and not having the ability to, what's the word I'm looking for, to just dye up 4 of them at the same time because of how my shop was structured, was very frustrating. And the more custom orders I got, I had 4 or 5 different colorways like this week, all single skein requests. So that's why you're gonna see in the shop update that I have you know, a few of each available on each base, because each of those colors was a custom order request and I'm not even done. I still have Whomping Willow to dye today, which I'm gonna do after I end this podcast. But I have to dye several because it's the only way that it makes it worthwhile for my time and the ability to provide everybody with the yarn that they want in a timely way.
I just got an egg.
You have an egg?
In the bowl.
Well, mommy's almost done, so can you go occupy your time while I finish up and I'll come out when I'm done? Okay. Sorry, more interruptions. Again, that's part of the reason why I can't do just a single dye, because I'm getting a larger number of custom order requests and they don't always sync up to the same colors. So it creates a lot of stress for me. My time is already very limited. If you guys know me, or you know, if this is your first podcast, I have 2 very small children. I'm a stay-at-home mom. I do this during the day. I manage my business during the day and then also after the kids go to bed, but a lot of my dyeing happens during the day during a 3-hour period that I like to call the sacred nap time. So I have to make sure that I'm using my time well. Anyway, so those changes are slowly rolling out right now, but lots of colors are still there. All the colors are still going to be dyed. If you have a request that I dye up some colors during the week, if you're like, oh yeah, I really wanted a skein of Dobby on everyday sock, I'm very happy to just dye up 4 skeins of everyday sock and then put the rest in the shop. But in terms of just dyeing a single skein for 1 person, 1 order, it's much more stressful for me, and I want to make sure that you guys get your yarn as soon as possible. I don't want you guys to have to wait in a 3 or 4 week queue like some other dyers may have for customs requests. I really like to keep things very succinct. I like things to get dyed, move out to new homes, and get shipped out in the same week. So anyway, let's get into what's in the shop. Okay, so we just had more egg in the bowl, as you can hear jingling away here. We have egg in a bowl now. Eggs in a bowl. Big news, guys. Okay, so here's what is in the shop right now. So I reskeined, finally, reskeined these skeins of Bellatrix. So these are 2-stripe, self-striping color Bellatrix. It is a gray tonal and a kind of a variegated purple with red tones splattered in it. Hi, Cece, I can see you. So I have 2 skeins of this available in the shop right now. As you can see, I'm holding them here.
I just don't lick it. It's really pretend.
It's pretend. Oh, please don't lick it. Ew. Okay. I have 2 skeins of Flowers for Dobby. These came out a lot lighter, on the lighter end. So if it's something you're interested in, 2 of these skeins are in the shop right now. Pink Speckles, kind of a grayish undertone. I have 1 skein of Molly on Simple DK that got added to the shop this week. I have a few Simple Sock of Molly right now. I did dye up 2 skeins, 1 on Sparkle and 1 on Everyday for customs requests that went out today. If you're interested in Molly, I can do another dye up, another round of dye up on different bases. I don't think I had much in the way of Luxe Sock or on Sparkle. In terms of my previous dye of the color, So if you have an interest in that, I can always do that. You just have to let me know. Either message me, put a comment here, message me on Etsy, whatever. Another dye up I did was Never Say Die. So this is my Stranger Things inspired colorway / Goonies inspired colorway. If you've never seen Stranger Things, it's an 80s themed sci-fi show, kind of a horror, sci-fi horror mashup. But this was based on the friends, the relationship of the friends. And it also reminds me of the Goonies because Goonies never say die. So I had to, this was the palette that I found for my inspiration. And yeah, so I have a couple skeins on Everyday Sock available in the shop right now. I have one skein of Elder Tree, which I've already held up, but this is a really nice earthy type color. So you can see, here we go, there are greens and browns and kind of more light brown colors, the gray, there are gray tones in here as well. So this was a custom request, but I dyed two instead of one, and so the other one is in the shop right now. And then Divination is in the shop. I did a huge dye up of this earlier this week. So the top is Sparkle, the middle is Simple Sock, and the bottom is Luxe Sock. So I have some of these available on these bases plus on Worsted. So I have it on Luxe, Everyday, Sparkle, Simple Sock, and Worsted Weight. So these are in the shop right now. There's a couple of skeins of each available. So if you like this color, you can go right ahead and grab it. They're sitting right there on my shelf. I'm happy to ship them to you right away. So there's that. And then, dun, 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 now for the sneak peek of this special collaboration. So if you guys have been around for a little while, you know that I've been dyeing up sporadically some self-striping yarn. I have a nice warping reel, which is sitting right here on top of the bed, but usually it's behind me, and it's where I can warp up yarn for doing self-striping colorways, and I have some pre-warped skeins, like long length skeins that became available through my supplier, and so I bought several bags of them because I wanted to try out doing some colorways of self-striping. So you've seen Narcissa and Bellatrix, those colors have come and gone so far of my dyes. I haven't dyed any more of those up. Those are all still from the first round, but I'm happy to dye more. And so I was talking with Lynn and I wanted to do another collaboration with her. So Lynn is of the Sunshine and Bubblegum podcast. She is a Massachusetts native, which is where I live. And she's living in Louisiana with her two sons, her twin boys and her husband. And every so often she comes up this way so we get to see each other. But she is such a sweetheart. She's a crocheter and a knitter. And she also sews project bags for her own pleasure. And she lists them on Etsy. And so over Christmas, we did a collaboration, and I'll put a picture here of the bags. So we had the hot chocolate bags in different colors, and I had some peppermint swirl colorway, which was just a red and white kind of ombre colorway that would micro stripe up the sock or pool up your sock, which was really kind of cool, which reminded me of like a peppermint stick. So peppermint swirl is the color. And so very simple color, but very satisfying, very cute. So we did those sets and we had four each in our shops and they were gone within an hour, like gone. Like people were fighting over it. One got double sold on my Etsy shop because two people checked out at the exact same time, which was really stressful. And I was like, oh my goodness. So I said, well, let's do another collaboration for the spring. And so she had sent me pictures of fabric like 2 days later. We picked a fabric, she started stitching on bags, and I started thinking of colorways. And so I knew I wanted to do a self-striping colorway. So this was the color that I had come up with, which is Fleur. I am gonna change it because now I've seen the bag like in real life and I want to incorporate some other colors in here. But this was just a three color self-striping yarn with navy, this kind of tealy green, and peach, like a very faint kind of skin toned peach for Fleur. And I'm still gonna call the yarn Fleur when I redesign it, but this is the bag. So this is absolutely gorgeous. I feel like I'm going to adjust this color the tones of the color to better match the colors that are in the bag. I really want to do this kind of like strawberry, peppery, cayenne type orange red, and then still do this lighter kind of tealy green, and then do this navy blue. I think that's what it's going to end up being, but I am working on that now. So Lynn did up these bags. They have a square box bottom. They're made with cotton fabric. You can see her logo there, sunshine and bubblegum. And then on the inside is this lovely kind of minty seafoam type green that matches the outside feathers. And they're drawstring bags. So I like drawstring bags because you can easily hook them onto your wrist. So if you're walking and knitting, you can kind of have it hooked onto your wrist. And I also like to fold over drawstring bags. So that's another reason why I was happy to collaborate again, because I really like the style of Lynn's bags.
Hey, what's in here?
So you can fold them over and it's very roomy on the inside. Yes, Cecilia?
What's in here?
What did you put in your egg?
I just put some crayons in.
Oh, you put crayons in?
Mm-hmm. Why, the green is stuck.
Uh-oh.
Thank you.
What? You got it?
I almost.
Anyway, so this is the bag. It's feathers. It's gorgeous. I love these colors for the spring. It makes me so incredibly happy. So I'm going to rework Fleur to better match the bag. This was three colors, and I think I might keep it three colors, or I might go down to two colors and kind of adjust. Ooh. Excuse me, I just had a coughing fit. Ooh. You know when you've been talking for so long, your throat gets really dry? Ooh. Okay, I think I'm done sneezing and coughing now that I'm successfully bleary-eyed. I think I'm going to adjust the colors in this to better suit the palette that's on the bag. Still keeping in mind Fleur, because I really do want to name it Fleur for the spring. Flower, Fleur, get it? But I want to pull like the colors that make me think of her. So I love the palette of this bag. It makes me feel like it's spring. It makes me feel very happy, kind of summery spring, you know. Anyway, so we're going to have a progress keeper. Lynn's sister Kira made some progress keepers for us that are feathers that are going to go with this. Got some tea, other little goodies that are going to go in the bag, and the yarn and a mini skein to coordinate, and this. So those will be coming to the shop probably in the next couple of weeks. I'm going to buckle down this week, just get everything dyed up, reskeined, and sent out to Lynn so that we can do this whole thing for the launch of spring. Let's bring spring in. So bags, so excited. I hope you're excited too. If you are, give it a like. Give this video a like if you are excited for bags, because I'm so excited. Okay. So I suppose that's the end of the podcast. I hope you guys enjoyed the podcast today. I'm happy that I was able to film today, that the weather permitting was really nice. So the light was a little bit touch and go. I cannot speak. So the light was a little touch and go, but in terms of the ability to film today, to get at least reasonable light, not too many interruptions from my little helper who's coming back, I think. And so so yeah. Anyway, have a wonderful rest of your week. Happy International Women's Day. If you like the podcast and you want to be subscribed, you can always hit the subscribe button down below. And you can see this face once a week or so. I usually try and film once a week. Next episode is going to be our 30th episode, which is unreal. I did not even think I was going to make 30 episodes. I didn't even think I was going to have 100 subscribers, and now I have over 600 subscribers. So, and I have all these people who are messaging me, and all of you guys in the comments and on the Ravelry group that always leave such wonderful feedback. So I'm just really thankful and just amazed at this wonderful community. So thank you so much for spending your time with me, interacting with me, liking, sharing, commenting, All those things are wonderful. You don't have to buy yarn from me. I just like to show the work I'm doing. You know, anyway, I hope you guys have a wonderful week. Keep making wonderful things, and I will see you in my next video. Bye.